Hello, I'm Caroline Jones. Tonight's program is about a terrible and haunting murder case and a former detective's long crusade. It all started 16 years ago with the murder of a 12-year-old girl called Leanne Holland. A family friend of the little girl was convicted and sentenced to life imprisonment. But since that time, ex-policeman Graeme Crowley has been reinvestigating and campaigning for a fresh look at the case. He's been joined by a broad-based group of supporters, some of them from inside the justice system. This is Graeme Crowley's story.
I mention the matter of the Queen against Graeme Stuart Stafford. An indictment has been presented to the court, charging him with murder.
Graeme Stuart Stafford, you stand charged by that name that on or about the 23rd of September 1991, in or around Ipswich in the state of Queensland, you murdered Leanne Holland. How do you plead? Guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
When you pull a brief apart, you're possibly going to find something wrong with it, you know. I just did not realise that I would find what turned out to be significant problems with virtually every piece of evidence that the Crown presented at the trial.
I'll put it to you that on that day you attacked Leanne with some heavy instrument like a hammer.
No.
And you cleaned up the blood in the house.
No.
I'll put it to you that you attacked her in the house and you later cleaned up the blood in the house.
No.
I think you've got a lot of people who don't know Stafford, but they have vested a lot of time into this over 14, 15 years. And I think it's not because they owe the Stafford family anything. They honestly believe there has been a miscarriage of justice.
Did you recognise any of those items of clothing, Graeme?
I recognise the jumper.
Are you able to say why during the police interviews you broke down and cried?
There's no one else fighting for him. I mean, I don't feel like I want to give up until it's been exhausted.
It wasn't a guilty conscience coming through, was it?
No.
Well, a lot of people say to me, why do you work on this? You know, here's a child killer. And sometimes I say, why am I working on this? And what happens if Graeme Stafford wakes up one day and says to the press, says to Australian Story, I did it, how will I feel? But then I get my sanity back and I think, he didn't do it. The real killer is out there now.
Leanne Holland was living with her father, Terry, in Alice Street, Goodna, in the western suburbs of Brisbane. Leanne was in grade 8 at school. Graeme Stafford was in a relationship with her older sister, Melissa Holland, and they were living elsewhere.
He'd been going out with Melissa for about 12 months, and then her father asked them if they'd live at his place, just to keep an eye on Leanne because he had to work. And if Melissa and Graeme were there, then there were more people to take care of her. So that's basically why they went and lived with Terry.
On the Tuesday afternoon, when no one had heard from Leanne, Melissa and Graeme Stafford became somewhat concerned. They went back, spoke to Terry. About 6 o'clock, they went down to the police station, Goodna police station, reported her missing to the police there.
I can remember Graeme ringing up, and I spoke to him, and he said, Leanne's gone missing. He said she didn't come home last night. And then the next day he rang me and said, Carmel, and he was like, you could just hear in his voice, he says, Carmel, the police have come and taken my car. He said, I don't know why, they've taken my car.
After a day of searching, two police trail bike riders found the girl's half-naked body in bushland, only 30 metres from busy Redbank Plains Road.
On the Thursday afternoon, some police trail bike riders found the body.
Scientific officers are searching the area. A cigarette lighter was found a short distance away, and police have begun taking plaster casts of a number of footprints.
On the Friday, they interviewed Stafford, and on the Saturday, they arrested him for the murder.
Graeme.
Graeme had never been in trouble with the police. I think he had got a fine one time for not having your seatbelt on. We thought, oh, it's all going to be a mistake, you know. We knew that he wasn't the type that would do anything like that. Not for a second did we think it.
The 28-year-old sheet metal worker will appear in the Ipswich Magistrates Court on Monday, charged with murder.
The Holland family initially accepted Graeme Stafford's innocence. They were very supportive of him. But I think the police team were able to convince them that they had the right man there.
When he'd been taken to the watch house and we went to see him there, the first words out of his mouth was, "How's Melissa?" So when he heard that she'd actually broken up the relationship, he was just devastated. It was like another blow on top of the first blow.
I met Graeme when I was about 23. Boyfriend and girlfriend, probably about 3.5 years. Graeme was a really, like, carefree, happy guy. He looked after my son, treated him like his own son. We split up only because we both had different priorities at the time, but we've always remained the best of friends. I first found out that Graeme was charged with this murder by police coming to my front door to ask me questions. They were quite persistent with sex questions. I was quite persistent in my answers, stating that no, he did not prefer to have kinky sex, he did not prefer to have sex toys, and in the end, when my answers didn't change, they just turned around and they said, "Oh, we can't use you as a witness. We're going now."
Today, prosecutor David Bullock said the Crown would allege Leanne was murdered by her sister's de facto husband. Stafford has pleaded not guilty.
When Graeme took the stand, he was very, very calm, very cool. It almost smacked of arrogance.
The accuser that stands before you is Graeme Stuart Stafford.
I thought a person that's under trial for murder would be agitated.
The prosecution is expected to call some 35 witnesses.
The Crown story was that on Monday, the 23rd of September 1991, Leanne Holland was on school holidays and Graeme Stafford was on a rostered day off. So he was the last one to see her alive.
What time did you come home from the shops?
5:15, I believe.
Well, the police case against Graeme Stafford was that he killed Leanne Holland. This must have happened between 10 o'clock on Monday and 4 p.m. in the afternoon. He allegedly then cleaned up the bathroom where the murder took place, took the body downstairs, put the body in his car, left it in the car for 2 days, and then dumped the body in bushland.
It was a very savage, brutal murder. She had been bashed repeatedly and without mercy. There was evidence that she had been sexually assaulted. There were marks on her body around her thighs, inner thighs, which were consistent with her being burnt with something, which looked like perhaps a cigarette in at least half a dozen places.
The jury was told blood, similar to Leanne's extremely rare type, was found in the boot of Stafford's car. Blood was also allegedly found in the bathroom, landing and steps of the house Stafford shared with Leanne, her sister Melissa and their father Terry.
This is a video that depicts those locations. I ask that it be played.
And the video of the scene was shown to the jury, and they were given the strong suggestion that there would have been plenty of blood around the place and that he must have cleaned it up.
The examination of the boot was conducted.
There was blood found on 3 items in the boot of his car.
And we located a maggot in the boot of the car.
There was a maggot found in the boot of his car, and that maggot was the same type of maggot as was found on the body.
The maggot was approximately 15 millimetres in length and was of a dark colour. It was still alive and wriggling.
The Crown case was that the body had been in the boot of his car for 2 days. So the blood and the maggot were damning evidence against him.
Do you recall driving along Redbank Plains Road going towards Ipswich?
Yes.
The Crown called 2 witnesses to say that they saw Stafford's car up next to the body on the Wednesday morning. Forensic police said his tyres imprints were found at the scene where the body was found, and he denied that his car was there.
Well, some of the evidence we had to look at, like we had to actually handle the clothing that was worn by Leanne when she was killed. Some of the pictures, the graphic pictures we had to go through and the descriptions of what happened and seeing the site where she was found and where she was supposedly murdered and all this sort of stuff, that was, yeah, really scary sort of stuff.
These are the matters that the Crown relies upon, that there was a hammer missing from the bedroom in the house.
Once the judge gave his summing up, the way he was summing up...
There was a maggot in the car.
We had no hope.
They refer to the car tracks at the scene.
It's a dreadful thing when it happens. You just feel like your heart's dropped through your body.
Do you find the accused, Graeme Stuart Stafford, guilty or not guilty of the offence of murder?
Guilty.
And it was just horrendous to sit there and watch your brother go to jail. It just rips your heart out, and there's nothing that you can do about it. It's just his life's taken away from him, and he's taken away from us.
For me to find Graeme Stafford guilty, it was quite an easy decision due to the circumstances and the facts that we were given. The facts were that the maggot in the boot, the blood in the boot, the location of the vehicle seen on site where the body was found, all those sort of things, the time frame, all matched up that Graeme Stafford was a party to it.
I was in the police 12 years. I was in the CIB for 9 years, conducted a lot of investigations. I left the Queensland Police in 1985, and subsequent to that started a private inquiry business.
And then the lady at the shops saw it around 12 midday with 2 youths.
About November 1992, the Stafford family came to me.
So I think it's quite very likely that they did see Leanne.
And they wanted some inquiries made.
And he had a couple of phone calls as well.
Yeah, sure.
He did say to us, well, I'll take it on, but if I find things that are bad for Graeme, then it means that he did do it. I'll be telling you that too. So I said, well, that's fine. Well, I worked it out. If it was 2:59 and he washed the car and then drove home, it would have taken at least 20 minutes to wash the car and drive home.
He wouldn't have been home much before 3:20.
Yeah, that's where I put
it. I'd had a background of locking guys up, not getting them out.
So the only time he really had to do it was from 9:30 to 11 a.m.
Yeah.
Or sometime between, what, 3:30
and 4:30?
3:30 and 4:30. I didn't have sympathy for convicted criminals. So when I first read the brief of evidence and read the court transcript, I was actually quite satisfied this guy had done this murder. But when I looked at the evidence, no one had actually checked it. Stafford had a legal aid solicitor. And I'm not having a go at legal aid, but I guess they didn't bother spending any money to test the evidence. And the barrister who appeared for him had the brief for 2 days before the trial starts, so how much work's he going to do on it, you know? He hasn't got any chance to do any work on it. And so it basically went through untested and accepted, and he's found guilty.
I think the police targeted Stafford from very early on. I think police, at the time, were under pressure. There were quite a few unsolved killings in Brisbane. I think from day one, they went for the most obvious suspect.
Everything I touched, there was a problem with it, and I was really surprised. It didn't matter what I looked at, it was just not straightforward. It was not as it appeared to be, and it was not as it should have been, and it was not the way it was given to the jury.
Were you able to look at the tracks in the soil?
The court was told that the tyres on Graeme Stafford's car matched with the tyre impressions found in the dirt where the body was found.
Any differences?
No, I could not find any differences.
When I viewed the overlays at the court, I wasn't satisfied that they were identical, and so I went to the tyre manufacturer and asked their opinion of the evidence.
They virtually said that the tyres were identical.
Mm.
My technical field services manager and myself did a lot of research on the actual tread patterns. We couldn't conclude that A, that were the exact same tyres that were on Graeme Stafford's car, or could we conclude that the tread pattern was identical.
Part of the evidence that did go a long way to convict Graeme Stafford were the two witnesses that were called by the Crown who said that they saw Graeme Stafford's shiny red Gemini sedan up in the bush on the Wednesday morning. When I compared their original statements with the evidence that they gave in court, I noticed several discrepancies. Both witnesses weren't sure on what day they saw the car up at the scene for a start, whether it was a Tuesday or Wednesday. One witness was quite sure that it wasn't a sedan, that it was a hatchback or wagon.
I was concerned about that because Graeme Stafford's car was quite clearly a sedan.
And the other witness changed her evidence at trial from her statement and told the court that she had been shown a photo of Graeme Stafford's car shortly before she gave evidence.
In 1994, when I went and interviewed her, she says, "I have to say, when I saw the photo of Graeme Stafford's car, I was a bit surprised by the colour. It was bright red, but the car I saw was darker in colour."
The end result was that the evidence of both people would be deemed unreliable. I submitted a preliminary report to the Stafford family. In the meantime, his solicitors sought leave to appeal to the High Court of Australia, and that leave was rejected.
In this country, in this day, if you seek leave to appeal to the High Court and it's dismissed, that's the end of the road. You do the time. So, I don't know, I just couldn't let it go. I felt I wanted to make some more inquiries. And I guess that's it, I just couldn't let it go. So I just kept looking.
He kept going on, and he did it at his own expense. So it's probably cost him quite a bit to keep going. And I think he gradually became to think like we did. Oh, gee, I don't think this guy really did it.
Hey, mate.
How are you?
Good to see you.
Well, it was about 12 years ago, and Graeme Crowley rang me up one day, and I sort of yawned and said, oh, I get these calls all the time.
I've just gone through the interview, and it really is confusing.
Graeme Crowley came down, and I said to myself, this guy's pretty convincing. He's an ex-copper.
Of interest which hasn't come up before.
He's very direct, he's very honest, he's very thorough.
Over 40 degrees. Maggots just won't live.
And then I looked at the material he left me, and I kept saying to myself, this can't be right. This guy couldn't have committed the murder. So I rang Graeme up and said, look, I want to be involved. This was a murder of great hostility, of great violence. I cannot think of any other murder like this where there has not been some indication in the past that the person has committed some sort of violence or has violent streaks. He's got nothing, no violent streaks in him whatsoever.
This is a continued take two of record venue.
The other evidence which comes up is the interview with Graeme Stafford himself.
Graeme, you agree that the time is 2:59 p.m?
Yes.
Right.
Two police officers interviewed Graeme Stafford in great detail and alleged that Graeme Stafford lied about dates and times. Well, you know, as a forensic psychologist and criminologist, I've gone through that interview, and it makes a mockery of what an interview should be about.
So in the original statement that you gave to us on Wednesday, you stated to us that you arrived home at approximately 2:30 to 3 o'clock on the Wednesday. That was in the original statement.
On the Wednesday?
Sorry, on the Tuesday, on the Monday.
The police officers themselves stumble over the dates and time, are confused about it themselves.
You agree that yesterday you stated that you didn't go to the car wash?
I didn't get away, sir. I wasn't here, sir.
Sorry, on Wednesday, yes.
The car wash was Tuesday, it wasn't Monday. I remember now because...
The car wash was Tuesday. Monday was your day off, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And you went to work on Tuesday, didn't you?
Yes.
It doesn't show that Graeme Stafford was lying at all. It shows very clearly that both Graeme Stafford and the police officers doing the interview were very confused about the sequence of events.
I'm not sure anymore. I have to be honest, I'm just so confused.
It was the start of the school holidays, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It's first day of the school holidays.
I was directed towards Graeme Crowley as a person who might make an interesting story.
It's inconceivable that you could just carry a body down those stairs without someone driving past and seeing it, I think.
He presented a lot of evidence on this case which seemed suspicious, that left a lot of questions hanging in the air, and we wanted to investigate it as well. Leanne's body was found about 10 kilometres away from the house. Now, the body had cigarette burns and torture marks from a lighter that had been heated up and put on her body. Now, being a non-smoker, Graeme Stafford was a non-smoker too. You don't suddenly light up a cigarette and start putting burn marks on a body. Those kind of things that you just don't, doesn't happen. That was just something right from the outset. Police should have said, well, no, it just doesn't make sense. There was another point to do with the car. On the first day Leanne went missing, about 4 or 5 o'clock, Melissa Holland, Leanne's older sister, came home from work and they went out shopping. Now this is according to the police, with the body in the boot. Now she could quite easily have put the shopping in the boot of that car, and he's discovered right away. Now what person in his right mind would take that risk? Either he's the smartest, cocky criminal you've ever come across, or not, and in this case, not.
The time of death in this murder investigation was extremely significant. The Crown case was that Graeme Stafford murdered this girl between 8 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. on the Monday.
In her original evidence, the forensic entomologist was asked to come up with a time of death based on the life cycle of the maggot. She later discovered that she'd been given the wrong basic information about what's called the ambient temperature in the area at the time.
When I made inquiries, I found there was a variation of some 2 degrees in the temperatures. I contacted the entomologist and asked if there was any significance in the different temperature, and she assured me that it was extremely significant. And she agreed to recalculate the growth rate of the maggots and thereby the time of death. And she came back to me and said that now, in her opinion, the time of death was around 10:30 a.m. on the Tuesday. On Tuesday, Graeme Stafford was at work all day, and the police verified this, and consequently, if the time of death is now 10:30 a.m. on Tuesday, he did not commit this crime.
I'm off to bed now. Thought you'd like a cup of tea, so...
Thank you. Good night.
See you in the morning.
By 1996, I'd essentially finished my investigations, and I felt that the evidence showing that Graeme Stafford had not committed this murder was overwhelming. The Stafford family approached a solicitor. They prepared a petition to the Governor of Queensland seeking a pardon or retrial.
This petition system is only available where, in effect, you can show that there is new or fresh evidence.
Graeme Stafford may have lost his first appeal, but this time his lawyers are feeling more confident.
There was additional evidence that the girl, Leanne Holland, had been seen after the time when the police maintained she'd been murdered.
But today, barmaid Christine Lawrence, who was never interviewed by police, told the appeal court she saw Leanne alive the day after she was said to have been murdered. The girl was sitting in a car parked next to hers at a shopping centre. Another witness, forensic biologist Leo Freeney, told the court...
Stafford's solicitors asked Leo Freeney, who was at that time the Crown's leading forensic scientist to review the blood evidence. And his evidence was fairly disturbing.
What the police said was, in effect, we believe that Graeme Stafford hammered this girl to death in the bathroom. We didn't find a lot of blood, therefore he must have cleaned it up. What Leo Freeney said was, no, there was no sign of a lot of a cover-up. Even if you look at the cracks in the tiles, there's no evidence suggests there was a big clean-up. Therefore, there never was sufficient blood to account for a death like this. Therefore, the death did not occur in the bathroom. There was insufficient blood even to account for a shaving cut, never mind a messy death with a hammer.
Even if Stafford had time to clean up, I've never seen, and I've been to hundreds of scenes and done thousands of court cases and 4,000 or so cases all up, I've never seen anyone successfully clean blood up.
Secondly, there wasn't sufficient blood in the car boot to account for a body having been put in there. And that links in with further forensic evidence to say that had the body been left in the car for that length of time, there would have been a strong odour of decomposing flesh, which there wasn't.
Freeney's evidence was essentially that, in his opinion, murder did not happen in the house at Alice Street in Goodna, and that Leanne's body had never been in the boot of Stafford's car.
I've had altogether about 40 years' experience in criminal law. Well, in my experience, the petition put to the appeal court was a very strong one. It proved that the fundamental assertion being made by the prosecution in the original trial was seriously flawed. Putting it in simple terms, if you like, the jury had been misled.
I was extremely confident. I felt that the chances of the appeal being denied were extremely small, and I just felt it was a walk in the park.
For my part,
the judges rejected the entire evidence.
Everyone seems to have missed the fact that the hammer was there. It hadn't been hidden by Graeme Stafford at all. It had been taken by the police.
Reality is that maggots don't get into boots of cars by themselves. At least one way or the other, it had to have some assistance.
From the forensic evidence, I don't think Graeme Stafford committed this crime. And I am prepared to say that publicly because I think he shouldn't be where he is.
I just feel that I have to do what I can to help Graeme out. I was part of putting him in, now I've got to be a part of getting him out.
He's now facing an outcome of being not only forever known as a convicted killer, but he's going to be deported.
I think I'm very close to being able to prove who killed Leanne.